Kinetic energy. Let's start here. Now, we did this for blobs in space. And for blobs in space, we were able to show kinetic energy was nothing but the kinetic energy off the center of mass plus kinetic energy about the center of mass. But this second term contains both deformational energy, if panels are flexing and doing or fuel is sloshing, and the rotational part, right? Now, let's use the same assumption. R dot for a rigid body, it doesn't go to zero, but the R dot just became omega cross R, right? The body relative derivative was zero. So we're also just going to focus on the rotational side. This is basically your translational energy, which comes out of your orbits class. We're not going to focus on orbits in here, just the rotational dynamics, so we're not going to cover that. And this is where I plugged in R dot is omega cross R. So you get a bunch of cross product, dot product, and you know, right away, there must be some magic trick identity that we can rearrange this, and that's kind of what I'm doing here, almost actually. First, and I'm using trig here, this omega is a constant as seen over the integration, right? If it's rigid, every point has to be rotating at the same rate. So this omega I can just take outside. Oh, there's a dot product. Okay, I did use a vector identity already to rewrite this into this form. And now I can take the omega outside with a dot product. Here, I'm still left with omega in the middle, but we have the trick that A cross B is minus B cross A. That puts it on the right-hand side, and you can take that one out as well. In fact, if you go back and look at HC, this whole definition is nothing but HC. In fact, this term becomes nothing but your inertia tensor times omega. And inertia tensor times omega was nothing but angular momentum about that point C. So it's nice. We now have rotational energy can simply be written as 1/2 omega dotted with angular momentum. Those are two vectors dotted together. When you dot them, mathematically, make sure they're taken with respect to the same frame. But here it's written in a frame agnostic way. So angular rotation, so that's the same thing. H is I omega. You might remember as rotational energy being inertia over 2 times angular rate squared for fixed axis rotation. This is the 3D version of that. You would have 1/2 omega transpose I omega. And that's basically inertia omega squared over 2, essentially. That's what it is. Power. We had earlier, if the time derivative from a blob, the first part, translation, was just force times the inertial velocity. Again, that's the translational side. What we do care about here is T dot. So if you differentiate this term, you will end up with this. Now to get this form, you need to have the rotational equations of motion, which we haven't derived yet. But I will let you, this is something you should make a note in an exam. Definitely go back and make sure you can go from here to here. I bet it simplifies. But the beauty of this is, for translation, we have force dotted with translational velocity. With rotation, you have torque dotted with angular velocity. It's really the same type of term that we're going to have. And that's what makes, this is what gives you your power rate for the system. When is T dot going to be zero? Let's ignore translation. We'll just focus on this. When is my power equation going to be zero, Shayla? What do you think? Without reading more. I want to hear you think.
The angular velocity is zero, or?
You could, if you're not spinning.
Center of mass is acceleration is zero. The RC.
Well, we're ignoring translation right now.
Oh, okay.
Just focus on this one, the rotational sign. What makes this second term go to zero? Omega could be zero, yes. It's kind of a trivial dynamical system then. Yes, if the energy is zero, then the energy rate is going to be zero. But that works. Yep. What else could you do?
I'll make LC zero.
So what is LC here? No? What is LC here? That's a torque. So this is a torque about point C. And in fact, when we get this torque, this torque is due to external forces when we derived all this stuff. So for this dynamical system, if your external torque on that rigid body is zero, you won't dissipate energy. This makes a great integration check. So as you guys are writing numerical code, you've got something, it's spinning, and there's no external torque on this system, I know energy has to be preserved. If we had h dot equal to l, that was the same thing. The angular momentum, as seen by an inertial observer, that's what that dot meant, right? Inertial derivative. As seen by an inertial observer, h has to be a constant vector if no external torque is acting on it. These things become fantastic integration checks. This is for a single rigid body, but even if you do multi-body, complex panels, flapping, reaction wheels, gyros, spinning, twisting, this stuff still has to hold, which is really nice. And now, if there is a torque acting on that system, I can actually predict very quickly how my kinetic energy needs to change. And this becomes a nice integration check because I can compute kinetic energy from the simulation numerically and then differentiate it to get T dot and compare. I know I applied this gravity gradient torque. This is my spin rate at the time. Energy should have changed by this many joules per second, right? So these tools become very, very useful validation tools, but also for analysis, you will see. So torque-free motion is when momentum is inertially preserved and kinetic energy is preserved because this is zero. The third option actually could exist in that the dot product goes to zero. Maybe you have very particular torques being applied such that no matter what your spin rate is, right now the torques are orthogonal to that. In that case, you have a non-working force acting on it. That's what they call it, because it doesn't, not doing work means it doesn't change my energy state. So there's three ways, either omega is zero, LC is zero, or those two things are orthogonal, then T dot goes to zero. And again, over, if you have the work done between points and time, you can do this with a time integral, or you can also do it in a spatial integral.